collaboration that I've been doing with some people from here, from Costa Rica, on mixed finite element method for some nonlinear problems in fluid mechanics. The idea of the mixed finite element method has to do with the possibility of incorporating new unknowns in addition to the original unknowns of the problem. So, first of all, I will talk about a coupler flow transport problem, which is a joint collaboration with Mario Alvarez from San Ramon, Christian Insunza, who is an undergraduate thesis student from Chile, and Ricardo Ruiz Bayer from the Oxford Mathematical Institute of the Oxford University. Actually, this is part of the PhD thesis that Mario Alvarez did in Concepcion some years ago. So the problem we are interested is the stationary state of transport of species in an invisible fluid, mathematically speaking, has to do just with the coupling between the Stokes equation, which is given here, and some diffusion equation. And the coupling is because of the fact that the viscosity depends on the concentration of the species. And at the same time, in the diffusion equation, there is a convective term depending on the velocity coming from the fluid. Also, the right-hand side of the Stokes equation depends on the concentration. So it's a couple. sigma IU. Once you have sigma IU, then you go to the diffusion equation and you put the sigma, the U and the phi, and then you solve for the diffusion equation. So therefore, the fixed point operator is going to be a combination of the S and the S tilde. And precisely in the one I'm showing here, this is our fixed point operator going from H1 into H1 plus the boundary condition. So it's S tilde of phi, S2 of phi. And then it's easy to see that solving the coupled system is equivalent to finding the fixed point for the operator T. Right? So the idea now is to solve this fixed point equation. And first of all, we realize that the operator S is well defined. That means that the equation for the fluid is solvable uniquely. And then we have that result here, which is just a consequence of the electricity. We have proved the electricity under certain conditions on this this parameter, kappa 2, kappa 1, kappa 2, and kappa 3, which are chosen, plus Lagrangian lemma, then you have one constant for the problem defining the stress and the velocity of the fluid. Similarly, one can prove that the problem defining the operator S tilde, which means solving the diffusion equation, that is consequence of the fact that you can prove that the resulting operator is strong monotone and Lipschitz continuous, which is very standard, under certain region of the given velocity u. So we are going to show existence within certain bound, not for every region, but under certain restrictions. So then, we'll assume additional hypothesis on the data, Lipschitz continuous hypothesis on mu and gamma. Then we also assume some linearity assumption on the operator S, which are pretty reasonable. Actually, one can prove this linearity estimate that you have something S, very small epsilon for each of the noun in the solution of the fluid equation. And with those tools, one is able to prove that the operator S is actually is continuous. This is the expression here. Here is some idea of the proof. You just use the strong monotonicity of the bilinear form B sub 5, and then once you have those terms, for the one written in red, you just use Cauchy-Schwarz, and for the one written in blue, you just use Hauler inequality plus some Sobolev injection, which are explained here, between H epsilon and some L epsilon star, depending on epsilon. The interesting thing here is that we are able now to see that when you choose this, in a suitable way, then you will have a compact injection for this operator S. So summarizing now for the operator T, which is the fixed point operator, then one can prove that this operator T is Lipschitz continuous. It maps the whole into itself, and the closure of it is compact because of this, the compact injection of H1 into L2 and the compact injection of H1 into L over N over epsilon, when, thanks to this Gordian compression compiler theory, N over epsilon is chosen greater than 1 when N equals 2, and between 1 and 6 when N equals 3. Okay? So, as a consequence, I didn't write the main theory, one can prove that in fact the fixed point equation has a solution, at least in that ball, right? It's a consequence of the Schaumburg theorem. Then we looked at the Galerkin scheme for it, and the usual for the equation, we use the Rabia Thomas spaces, which are polynomial, special kind of polynomial spaces, Pk vector version of Pk plus Pk scalar times x. So basically, the space for sigma for the stress is Rabia Thomas, the space for u is the usual Lagrange element of order k plus 1. And the space for the concentration is the same Lagrange finite element of order k plus 1. So then you have this augmented Lipschitz primer Galerkin scheme. That's exactly the same form of the continuous equations. And again, you can also define it. I'm not going to do it because of time, but you can also define a fixed point, a discrete fixed point operator, similarly that you need for the continuous state, defining that SH and ST, the H, the discrete analog of levels. So we can prove then that again the solving the Galerkin scheme is equivalent to solving a discrete fixed point equation in our finite space for the concentration. And in this case, we just apply the proper fixed point theory to conclude only the existence of solution. We don't have uniqueness in this case. Some example, here we have a 2D example for the manufacturer example that you know. The data, the exact solution, and here you have the parameter, the optimal way to choose the parameters, and here we have the order of convergence. I didn't put the theorem, but you can prove that the order of convergence is k plus 1. So in this case, we're taking k equals 0. So you have k plus 1, where you compare it for phi, for sigma, and for u. And from k equal 1, okay, you expect 2, but you get the order of convergence 2, and also from this case, and you use the right. Here are some pictures of the solution, some components for the component of the stresses, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 2, and so on. Here are some components of the velocity, and here the concentration. A 3D example in which we don't know the solution, just to see how the method works. Here we have the data, the boundary, in this case the viscosity is constant, the given gamma, the given diffusion is also a constant. Here is some explanation of the physics that is going on here, and also the definition of the parameter we need to use. And in this case, we have very nice pictures for the isosurfaces of the temperature here, and here we have the streamlines of the fluid. And again, here we have the some component of the stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2-3. All the details that I summarized in this brief description can be found in this paper already published with Mario and Ricardo Ruiz in the Mario Monomic Analysis in 2015. Some related work that we have done, actually, in the model I just presented, the diffusion coefficient depends on the gradient of the concentration. Actually, it's much more physical to assume the dependence only on the concentration, which is very typical in sedimentation processes. So then we already extended our analysis to this case, and we assume this dependence instead of that, and that was also published recently in 2016 in Mathematical Model Method in Applied Science, the same process. Something else that we have doing in this direction, a posteriori error analysis, for this problem, one which is already published, and another one which is submitted. This is this one for the one I described, and this one is for the case in which the diffusion coefficient depends only on the concentration. Work in progress. What we are doing now, we are extending all our ideas now to work with an augmented fluid deformation, in which also in the equation for the concentration we also use a mixed formulation. That means the finite tilde, sigma tilde, as this expression here, and then we need to introduce the grade of phi as an additional function. This is a work under in progress with this thesis as you have said. What we plan to do in the future is to extend these ideas to the case instead of solids, considering a mere solids, and understand that there's an application, but don't ask me about the people that don't know which are, but it's very similar to Boussinesq. And also non-stationary problems, something that we also plan to do in the future. That was the first summit I wanted to say. Just try to show a small description of what I've been doing with my collaborator from here from the summit. The second thing has to do with the stationary Boussinesq problem, which is a joint work with the Javier Monacina and the client is a student from Gabriel Campo from here from the Federal Mathematica SIMPA, Enrico Gurmenare from Venezuela, which is now in Chile, and Ricardo Yasuda also from Concepcion from Chile. This has to do now with the stationary Boussinesq problem, which is again a couple problem, but then it's instead of the Stokes equation, we have a kind of Navier Stokes equation with the right hand side depending on the temperature. You may also think of this as the concentration of some species also. Alright? And at the same time, the equation, the heat equation here, which is marked by now the temperature, this equation here depends on the velocity. So here are the norms, U the velocity, the pressure, and the temperature of the fluid. Mu is the viscosity, G is the data. Mu B is the direction of the data, also known. Phi, or phi B is also data. K is a given tensor describing thermal conductivity. And some example of this equation appears in heat pipe, heat exchanger, cooling processes, your physical. And I guess there are no other examples where you can apply this model. In this case, as I said, we are interested in mean correlation, so we introduce the tensor or the solid stress tensor. So the idea here is to introduce now this solid stress tensor in which the convective term is taken care of by this tensor product here. This u times u is just the velocity u times the velocity u as a row, here as a column. This is that tensor u times u. And so the original equation can be written in this way in terms of this unknown sigma. So we have, again, similarly as I did in the other example, one can eliminate the pressure. So we get now that this can be written in this way, because actually the pressure can be obtained in terms of sigma and u, which is actually this very same equation here divided by the measure of 1 over n, something like that. And because of the uniqueness of pressure, then you need to impose this condition in your sigma. So, the first part, the Lebesgue equation, then are rewritten according to this new and now here sigma. So it's written in this way, in which we have eliminated the pressure, just sigma and velocity. And the heat equation is just kept in the same way as it was before. All right. So again, the double thing. So the mean correlation for the flow, we have then this phi sigma u in these spaces, and then originally we have this kind of saddle point problem of this h of n here. And for the heat equation, because of the direction of the boundary condition, we have to impose, since we are using the primary calculation here, then we have to impose this condition quickly, which means that we have to introduce a kind of Lagrange multiplier. So this normal flux is playing a role in this Lagrange multiplier. Okay? For this direction. So this is the saddle point problem for the heat equation, and as you can see, this equation depends on the velocity coming from the fluid. Right? So similarly as the other case, we observe now that because of this inequality here, some embedding of solid spaces, we are going to look for the u also in H1, and here again the same reason that before. So we augment our mixed population also with suitable terms. The same continuous terms, but tested differently in a convenient way. So we get this equation here for the fluid, which depends on the right hand side on the temperature, and here we have the saddle point problem for the heat equation, which depends on the right hand side of the velocity coming from the fluid. And here is the equation for this. I mean the equation for B, which is just a convective term. So how it's going to work here, the fixed point idea. We, given a velocity u and a temperature phi, we replace this u here. So we make the constant here linear. Because this is nonlinear because of this term here. The rest is linear. So we put, given a u and a phi, put it here. And then we solve for the fluid equation. While we have the u, then we plug it into here. And with the same phi, we put it here. And then we solve for the heat equation. So that defines the fixed point operator. Here it's again. So we have two operator S going from H into this space, given a W and a phi, you put the W here and a phi here, and then you solve this in a problem. Again, that's being observed, we put that this is going to be a linear. Alright? And we get still then, given the W and the phi, you put the W and the phi on the right hand side, and then you solve this in a problem, this a solid point problem using Babushka breathing. Right. So the operator T, which is the fixed point operator, is going to be, of course, a combination between the S and the ST. And this expression is this one here. Okay? It depends on those two variables. And therefore, I didn't mention it before, but as for the other case, in this case also, the eventual leakage continuity of T is certainly going to depend on the eventual leakage continuity of S and ST. Right? So here we have then a compound problem, which is equivalent again to a fixed point operator depending on velocity and temperature. Here a summary of the way we analyze this. solvability of the fixed point equation first. As I said, proving that the average of S is well defined depends just purely on the electricity of this plus Lapmian lemma. Proving that the average of S still is well defined is just Babuska-Bessie theory. And then for G, via fixed point theory, here we don't have compactness, as you may see, because we have it, we can prove that the operator T is certainly Lipschitz continuum, but with the same norm coming from the measure T is the same norm here, so we have no choice, I mean no possibility of obtaining compact. So we only have can prove under a small, sufficient to small data, we can prove the uniqueness of solution for our carbon system, thanks to the finite point theory. For the galactic scheme, again, we have the augmented mixed primary electric scheme, the fluid, the heat equation, and again, you can define a fixed and distinctive smart operator TH. So, in this case, also, we are going to show using the discontinuity of the distinctive smart operator, the existence of solution by the parameter theorem, and in this case, assuming additionally that the data is sufficiently small, then we have uniqueness. And therefore, the error estimate. Using the well-known strong estimate, but again, as an assumption on the small data, we can prove shear estimate, and of course, as usual, having the shear estimate plus regularity, you can prove rate of conversion for the method. Okay. All further details on this subject can be found in this paper already published in American Methods of PDE. Some related work that we also need, but to do now with using a mixed formulation also in the heat equation. And the idea there is the final net is P as this additional unknown, so therefore the equation can be written in this form. And then you obtain the gradient in terms of P in this equation here. So this is the one that you are going to integrate by part in order to have the operation of formulation. For this mixed formulation is also already published in Macoro this last year. We also did a posterior error analysis for this problem. It's also published, and this is for the mixed primer formulation. But we also did for the fully mixed formulation. This is currently submitted. And what we did more recently is assuming now that the viscosity depends on the temperature. In the Navier-Stokes equation, the first one, that it possibly depends on the temperature, but that also we have some pressure direction, which are already submitted. That's for the periodic analysis, and this is for the a posteriori analysis of the only. Work in progress, this is exactly what we are doing with the paragraph here, over here, which has to do with a new Fourier formulation, which has, the idea here is to define the additional unknowns for the new formulation in a different way, kind of trick. Putting this one up here, I don't have time to explain why, but this is work already in progress, so we're going to finish it like this. So this is just a unit kind of method. But the advantage of this, I'm going to mention that, the advantage of this is that we don't need to augment the equation in that sense. But on the other side, doing the augmentation, we have, because of the electricity, we have more freedom to choose the finite element size spaces. So perhaps. One advantage and one disadvantage of the method. Future work, we also plan to do some non-stationary problem. I'm tired already, but I will continue. The third topic I wanted to talk is about the topic that we have been doing recently with Brian Lopez, also from here from Costa Rica, from the San Ramon. He's currently doing the PhD thesis under my direction and the direction also regarding the brain. And we are doing here the stress-assisted diffusion problem. It has to do with the diffusion of the solute into an elastic or a viscoelastic or whatever material. Diffusion of the solute into material. Mathematically speaking, again, this has to do with the coupling between the elasticity equation and some diffusion equation. In which, in the elasticity equation, right-hand side depends on the concentration of the solute. In turn, the diffusion coefficient depends on the stress coming from the system. But ideas are very similar, but again, we have a couple of problems. So here we have the unknowns. Sigma is the total energy, so the stress mu or lambda and the constant, u displacement, d of u displacement, strength tensor, or the symmetric part of the gradient. Here is a signal in front of the electricity flux. Phi, this is substance at the concentration. This is a nonlinear sensorial experiment and scalar function. Some application, as I've been told by Ricardo, this has an application in diffusion of arsenic and silicon, hydrogen diffusion in metals, absorption in polymers, and perhaps many more applications that I can. So, what we do here is a unique formulation for the elasticity, the usual one. So we have the stress displacement rotation, unique formulation for elasticity, which is over here. This is the typical form of the Balean form A, the Balean form B, and the elasticity. The right hand side here for the surface depends on the concentration. That's the only thing happening with the other equation. And then for the diffusion equation, we just use the primary formulation, which means solving this problem here, in which the binary form depends on the stress coming from the elasticity equation, and the right hand side depends on the displacement coming also from the elasticity equation. So the concept is a different one. But the idea we're going to use is basically the same thing we have mentioned for the other cases, has to do with a fixed point with this value. So here we have the next kind of formulation with the whole thing. This is for the elasticity, this is for the diffusion equation. And again, we can define an operator T, which is going to be our fixed point operator. And I omit further detail because it's quite similar to what I did. But there are certain differences. I don't think I have time for that. I think it's different. It's fine. Galerkin scheme, again, mixed primer Galerkin scheme for this. I didn't even mention the spaces, but you can guess for the elasticity, we use gears for the residual and marine or whatever. And for the diffusion equation, we use the Lagrange element for the K plus 1. And so here we have some an example, a 2D example with a given solution, certain parameters, and so on. And again, here the rate of conversion is again K plus 1. And as you can see, the rate of convergence are attained in all the amount of sigma for U for the vortex, for the rotation, and for the concentration in this case. K plus 1 in all the cases here too. And there's some picture of the magnitude of the stresses, to get the magnitude of the rotation, and here you have the concentration, and here you have the magnitude of the displacement of the sun. For the details of this subject that we found in this paper was already submitted to Mr. Bryan. Related work that we also did is now again a fully mixed formulation. In addition to using the mixed formulation in elasticity, we also use this formulation for the diffusion equation. Plus, the term here are the main ideas to define T of the rate of phi, sigma tilde, the diffusion depending on the stress time T, and so on. This is also a paper which is currently submitted. Work in progress, we are doing the theoretical analysis of these two problems, and also we plan to do some non-stationary problems. That's all part of the PhD thesis that we are doing right now with the project. Last but not least, Philip, I will talk a bit about what I've been doing with Philander Sequeira from the Mathematical Universidad Nacional and some people from Concepción. This is a former undergraduate student who is currently doing a PhD in Brown. Mauricio Mugana from Colombia is doing a PhD with me in Concepción. We are working on virtual element method. Virtual element method is a new idea proposed by some Italian mathematicians very recently. As Fila said before, this is a new toy to play with, virtual elements. Like many other toys that we have in numerical analysis, I don't claim that one method is better than the other. They are compared, one is better than the other one for certain cases and so on. So we wanted to have some experience with this virtual element method, and we did something in this direction. This wasn't part of the PhD thesis of Fila, but the other is really something different. I don't remember what it was, but we did something different. Right. So, he was so active, I wanted to keep him very busy. So then I said, okay, let's do virtual elements. Okay, we are looking for a very simple model, which is the square, rectangles, the tetrahedra, whatever. But in general, it's arbitrary geometry under certain conditions. So the major version of LSE, what are the main ideas? The composition of omega in polygonal elements, polygonal. The k number of edges of the element, h3, the big diameter. So basic assumptions. At least there is a certain constant such that the shortest edge is bounded below by the diameter time this constant. And this is another important restriction. Even, I mean, you may say that you have a general polygon, but then they have to be star shaped with respect to certain mode. That's another restriction. So, as a consequence of those restrictions, then you have that the elements are always simply connected. And the number of edges of each element is odd, depending on this given constant. So those are the main restrictions. The second thing that defines the virtual element is the fact that you don't know the approximation angle in the whole domain. You just know how it behaves in certain part of the domain. For instance, you know the normal component of it, you know the divergence of the curve of the test. So this is the definition of the, that's because of the name virtual. You don't know exactly the solution in the whole element, but in part of the element. For instance, you know that the divergence is a polynomial of degree k, the curve of Rutherford is the constant number of degree k minus 1, and the normal component is a polynomial of degree k on each edge of the bar. And the idea then is to be able to identify uniquely those functions in the virtual element basis by knowing this thing here, which are going to be the degrees of freedom. So at the end of the day, you won't know the solution, but you will know the degrees of freedom. So when you actually, what you look at the picture is the projection of those virtual solutions into some polynomial space. This is what you show. So, here the definition of the local degrees of freedom. You know the normal components against all the polynomial degree k. You know this against the grade of k from k in polynomial degree k. And then you know against certain polynomial in certain orthogonal space within pk. This is the vector here, and the total number of degrees of freedom for this. So one can prove that the elements in this space are unisolvent with respect to all these degrees of freedom. But as I said, all we know about this virtual solution are the degrees of freedom. But the interesting thing is that knowing the degrees of freedom, you are able to compute the projection. And that's what we are going to show at the final solution. So here, since we have the tensor, so we do the same for the tensorial local virtual freedom space, which means the final along the rows. So we have, again, the insolvency with respect to basically the same degrees of freedom as before, but now along each row of the tensor. What's the point of the projector? What use the usual L2 orthogonal projector onto the polynomial degree k? The approximation properties are also known. Remember that k now is a polygonal element, but the results are already known. And the other thing that you have to take care of is being able to compute the projection for the virtual solution. Or for the element of the virtual space. You need to do that. Not any projector will work. And then you have the local interpolation operator for the virtual space, which is, of course, the interpolator are those which have the same degrees of freedom of the given count in the virtual in H1. So then you have now the global virtual space of HD, which is basically the one that you have on each row, and the global interpolation operator, which is just the extension to the whole domain of the whole triangulation of the operator that you have in each element of the triangulation. Here you have the local multilinear form, and since the content of the virtual element scheme first is defined a computable discrete version, because this here you cannot compute, because you don't know the virtual solution, but you do know the divergence. So this piece of the Valina form can be computed explicitly. You know that. But you don't know this. So what you're going to do is just to replace those in here by
the equation is explicitly known for the element in the virtual, the local virtual element space. What about that? And here is the answer. Replace that by a suitable bridge. And then add something else to summarize the resulting binary form, because you are going to modify the original binary form by replacing those pieces here from the projection that they're going to be different. Then you need to summarize. So, and here you have the computable, the speed version of the nonlinear form. Then you have the projection as it is. And here you have the stabilizing term, which depends on the degrees of freedom. I don't want to say much about it. First choice for the space where you project, and for the projector, the first choice is just the element 2 projector, which can be computed for the element in the visual interface. And here you have the dimension of that based on your projection, okay, plus 1 times the vector. And this is important to observe that this relation can be computed in the virtual element space, in the element of the virtual element space. And you have that it is involved. And you have also approximation problem. A second choice is one that we are taking from some previous paper on a virtual element method, which is actually the same thing we need for the Stokes equation, that solves shunt velocity formulation for solid stress, in which we define a particular projector which takes into account the form of the solution. And the form of the solution, sigma, is the gradient, basically is the gradient of u, and u has divergence 0. At some time, we look for the projection into this space of polynomial, the gradient of something which has divergence 0. Gradient of curve, that explains why we choose that. Because the continuous solution has that property. It's the sigma, basically, is gradient of the velocity, which is inclusive. And this is a special predictor that works for the Stokes, but it also works for the our present case. And I remember the referee of this paper asked which one we prefer. And we said this one, and not because this one was done by us, but because the degrees of freedom are cheaper. It's k plus 1 times k plus 4, and the other one is k plus 1 times 2k plus 4. So our achievement. But the result are basically the same. Okay, so here then you have the global now, the big bilinear form, which is just the sum over all the elements of this big bilinear form that I have just defined. So our alerting scheme for the visual element space is now given in this way. We have this modified bilinear form, the right hand side. The right hand side is the same as input, the right hand side can be computed implicitly because it depends on the divergence, but it depends on the normal component. And those are part of the degrees of freedom that you know for the virtual game. So one can prove that this bilinear form is strongly elliptic, it's a constant independent on H. You can prove then the continuous dependence on the data. And then if you define the global boundary part of the projection that we are choosing, then we are able to prove this theorem for the error estimate. The error sigma depends on the projection error onto the virtual element space and the projection that we are given, and two for the particular boundary function. And according to the approximation properties of this projection that we know them, we are able to prove this rate of convergence. But for sigma h, which is the virtual solution, as I said, we don't know it explicitly. We just know the normal component, we know the divergent, we know the rod, but we don't know how much it is in certain spaces of the point of the domain. Right? So then, we do next is a computable approximation of sigma p and u. Although we propose for the approximation for sigma finite, the projection of the virtual solution. And then we are able to prove this error estimate now for the computable approximation of sigma. And also for the computable approximation of the pressure, which is given by this processing formula. And then defining this equation in this way, because of the equation for F, we are also able to prove this error estimate for the computable approximation of the velocity. Here we have the global rate of conversion for sigma, for the pressure, and for the velocity. The highest rate that the conversion that we get is k plus 1. For some part in with the solution sufficiently smooth, we have k plus 1. Some numerical results. In this case, here you have the vacuum skin, the number of degrees of freedom in the whole system, the error, the flow of error, the rate of convergence, and so on. Here we have a manufactured example. We are given some domain with a known solution. And here we have the solution with the virtual element space with quadrilaterals and using the N2 projection. K plus 1 is set, K plus 1, K plus 0, K plus 1, K plus 1, K plus 1, K plus 1, and so on. All the rate of convergence predicted by the theory are obtained in this example. Refinement with quadrilaterals again, and using our projection in that paper, we obtain more or less the same result with the rate of convergence that were predicted by the theory. Refinement with exams also is possible using the CD projection, also very good result. And here's some example of the solution, the component of the stresses, sigma H11, this is one supposed to be the exact solution and one is the approximation. Oh no, I'm sorry, this is with exam and this is with the quadrilateral. And here we have approximation for the first component of the velocity with quadrilateral and with exams. Okay. All the details of this paper, this subject can be found in this paper of the public with nonlinear and classical classes and nonlinear modes of applied sciences. This year, related work that we already did in other mixed virtual investment for mechanics, where I didn't mention before, this paper with the metal classes for the solution of the stock problem. Actually, it was our first paper in this direction. But recently, we extended this approach here to the case of what we call the quasi-nonlinear stock flow, and in which the viscosity of the fluid depends non-linearly on the gradient of the velocity, and that this is this paper already published in CINUM just recently this year, this year for the reversal of quasi-nonlinear stock flow. Since other things that we are doing, with the recent nonlinear victory for the reversal for the reversal equation, submitted for the non-linear version with the same model that I explained, the brain one, but the non-linear version with of it, submitted. And also for the elasticity, we have something in the direction of solid strength based on the relation of linear elasticity, also submitted. Work in progress. We're working on potential implementation with you are mixed pain for the resource equation. Actually, because this paper is only 3 terms out. The potential implementation we're going to do in a different report. I was very nice. Future work, what we plan to do for